is episode 86 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. We're always looking for great new members, so if you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about the group. For January 2018, we're discussing The Sandcastle Girls by Chris Bohjalian. So hi, I'm Millenia in Florida.
And I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And Roberta and I are two members of the Reading Cove Book Club, and we're here today to discuss our group's 206th pick, The Sandcastle Girls by Chris Bohjalian. And it was chosen by Cove member Sally down under in Australia. We've already completed our discussion with the rest of the group, so we're just going to share our thoughts and the group's overall impression of The Sandcastle Girls. I wasn't a huge fan, but I think you liked it a lot more than I did, right?
Yes, I did.
So tell us why.
Well, I was very impressed with all the research the author did about the history thing, as we discussed online and in other ways that I had never known about this horrible time in history. It's not one of the things they teach you in school. Mm-hmm. And I think it's another one of those things that, you know, history's tried to downplay. But, you know, I wasn't aware of this horrible genocide of the Armenian people by the Turkish people at the, early part of World War I. And I was, you know, in touch by the emotional thing that they compared this to, since part of this book, was presented at the actual time these horrible things happened back in, 1914 or so. And then others were the more modern thing where a woman was looking back at what had happened with her, relatives and all. But, she was comparing it to these other more recent genocide that most people are familiar with in Uganda and Rwanda and, of course, the Holocaust and things like that, that, even though this took place at the beginning of the 20th century, there's been a lot more later on in the 20th century, and there's still, seems to be horrible things going on now where people are trying to get rid of huge groups of people that don't think the same way they do.
Mm-hmm. Or who are just weaker.
Yes. Yeah. So, and I thought the author had done a lot of research and a fine job of bringing this to life. And with his last name, apparently, he appears to be of Armenian background himself. Mm-hmm. And on a humorous note, until I read this book, I guess I hadn't thought that much about, being Armenian or having that. But I didn't realize that the ever-present Kardashians have, come from Armenian stock, too. So many of these things, like a lot of people, have kept a lot of things to themselves. It was harder to find out what truly happened.
Well, for me, I didn't know much about this history either. It's funny because I just think this author's style just isn't for me. Like I said in the discussion, I didn't really enjoy Midwives either by him. And I just find it really dull and monotonous. And it was like the case of where an author just takes something that's supposed to be really gripping and compelling, and then the way they tell it just makes it really boring. That's what happened with this one for me. I thought Laura, who was in the present day, I didn't think her point of view was all that well written, because the tone was off. She would just, contrasting with the past, what was going on in the past, and her portions, the tone was strange. She would just start cursing, like using swear words out of nowhere, and it just didn't seem to fit with the historical piece for me. It felt really off. And I just didn't find her very compelling. And then in the past story, because it kept going back and forth, often in the same chapter, which I think kept me from being able to connect with anyone. Because I think if you're going to change time periods, it should be separated by chapters, not just within the same chapter. And I think other people in the group had talked about that too.
Well, yeah, I have to agree with that point. That was one thing that, made it a little harder for me, because I do like to know where I am when I'm reading, and things like that do kind of get on your nerves or make it harder to follow things.
Yeah. And then Laura's narrative would just have some historical information dumps that made me feel like I was in history class rather than in a real person's point of view. You know what I mean? She would just start giving these statistics or these just information dumps. So I felt like she was more like a reporter than a granddaughter trying to research about her family history. I thought she could have been written a little bit better, a little bit more engaging.
Yes, well, I have to agree with you part of it, but I think personally I would have liked the book even more if it had all taken place during this historical point of time.
If it would have felt more even.
It would have felt more even. I have to agree with that. And then even the surprise you get at the end about what really happened to Armin's mm-hmm. first wife, what really happened, that's still, you know, if you'd had the whole thing from a third person or omnipresent, you know, present point of view, then that would have worked too. So
a little bit better, yeah.
A little better. So I think that would have made it a more palatable book for, you know, many of our Cove readers too. And I would have liked it even better, because sometimes the switching between time periods, it makes it more interesting. But personally, I think in this case, it would have done better being historical fiction just set in the historical time.
Agreed. And I think usually when authors do this, it's separated by chapter, and and that makes it completely separate from each other. But this would just shift from section to section. You go from Laura all the way back to Elizabeth and Armin on the same page. And
right.
Yeah, I think many people were turned off by that. The other point that I noted, I think that, like you said, some people are learning about this, like us, for the first time, or learning about it more in depth. And I think that can be compelling in and of itself, separate and apart from the way the story is told. You're just so interested in this point in history and what happened that holds your attention by itself, right?
Correct.
Yeah, that didn't really happen for me. I think the most compelling part for me was when, what's his name? The American consul, when they were in Aleppo, and I think his name was Ryan.
Right.
And
yes.
Yeah, he was speaking with one of the Turkish officers and trying to get permission to bring aid to the refugees. And this Turkish officer was like warning him that they could maybe kill him or kill him and his envoy, and it could be a dangerous trip. And I remember thinking, no, the refugees won't kill them. Maybe the Turks will kill them and then try to blame it on the Armenians.
Right.
Right. And so that was the only time I remember feeling like, oh, you know, I really wanted to see what would happen when they went off on this trip. And then what ended up happening was they were stopped by the Turkish officers and they took their goods.
Right. Sort of. And unfortunately, I think that still happens nowadays, is a lot of places that different groups try to send aid to, a lot of it gets taken along the way as sort of like as bribes, or as people thinking, well, that's their fair share of or what's being given. And so it doesn't always get, just like in this case, it doesn't always get to the intended people.
Yeah. But Elizabeth was able to kind of use their religion against them in a way to get them into letting them take something. And then when they get there, they realize it was pretty much useless because there are no stoves. There's nothing there to prepare food and things like that. So yeah, it was just a really bad situation. And then, of course, there is the counter argument from the Turks. And I'm not sure who else might agree with them, that the so-called genocide is exaggerated by the Armenian people and by other international countries, that they exaggerated, that there was really a civil war going on between the Armenians and the Turkish people. And it wasn't anything like the way the narrative is being told today. That's the position of Turkey and a lot of Turkish people.
Well, of course, they're not going to think that their country did something so horrible.
Exactly.
You know, just like these other people try to distance themselves from these horrendous things. But, you know, and you want to believe the good about people, but then there's been too many horrendous things that happened during the 20th century that you really want to believe the horrible stuff over these people trying to make excuses in denial. But too many terrible things have happened over this century and centuries in the past, you know, where just it has been wholesale genocide on a big level. So, you know, especially this country, we're not without shame on several levels. So, you know,
exactly.
History has shown what people, the terrible things people are capable of, along with the good things.
And then there were a lot of gruesome parts that I skimmed over, like when they were traveling through the dead bodies.
Yeah.
Armin was killing people when he went off to the front. It was gross.
It was, but I think, you know, and I'm not saying that I like a lot of gruesome stuff, but I'm just saying I think the author was really trying to make the point of this is the horrors of what... really like, you know, with Armin, you know, supposedly a good person, but he was a soldier too, and then he had to kill those other officials because it was either kill or be killed. And, you know, most people have a strong sense of self-preservation about things, so. But yeah, that, you know, sometimes authors go a little overboard, the gruesome factor, just to make a point, and you could think it could be a little bit downplayed, but I think that's what he was going for, the author, is to shock value and the thing, like, people, this was just worse than you can even imagine.
Yeah, so, he was trying to bring it to life so people could, yeah, like, paint a vivid picture.
Right. But, I mean, there was some uplifting stuff, too. I think the thing that was the most touching to me at the end, I mean, the thing about with the wife and everything was sort of like, ooh, you know. You know.
Oh, you mean Katrina.
Yeah, but then looking back, you think, well, yeah, there was kind of hints and everything. But the one uplifting thing is to see that Elizabeth came in contact with these people, you know, with Hatun, you know, that had the little girl. And you were thinking, well, you know, will she ever make it out of even this terrible situation? And, you know, is she ruined and traumatized for life? But she, you know, that was very uplifting to me, that she was able to make a new life for herself and turn into a good woman and, you know, go on with her life and not be totally traumatized by the horrors of the war and everything.
Yes, and I thought it was a little bit, there were a couple moments where there were some dots that weren't that close together, and I thought it was a little bit contrived and convenient that Elizabeth would figure out who Katrina was.
Right.
And then the same with Laura figuring out Hatun.
Right. That,
yeah, it was like rushed, because it was like, oh really, she would have figured it out that quickly. But yeah, I understand, and I agree, it was uplifting.
It was uplifting after all this terrible stuff that happened. You know, it was.
Yes, but he should have spent some more time on that aspect instead of...
I know. I would have liked to, that's one thing I think, and I just I would have liked to know a little bit more about what
Hatun, yeah.
How, you know, she had made it from being a small child to, you know, making it to America and what had happened to her. So
yeah. The Germans who were taking photos, and then the Turkish soldiers were trying to force them to get rid of them, to destroy them.
Right.
And that one soldier who decided, you know what, he wanted to preserve it.
Right.
As proof that it happened.
Right. Because I think he could already see that people will be in denial, and for all the, you know, terrible things that the Germans did in the First World War, at least here's somebody that was, you know, he was a good far away from Germany, but he was trying to show that these terrible things happened, because he figured otherwise they'd be just kind of brushed under the rug and no one would know how bad it really was.
Was the guy who buried them, what were they, like plates, photograph plates? Was he a German or was he a Turk? I thought he was a Turk.
Well, I think he got them from the Germans. So,
right. You know. And he was charged with destroying them.
Right.
Right, but he was Turkish.
Right, but,
you know. My memory serves me, because I thought, oh, that's interesting that he, as a Turkish soldier, he's the one who decides to save these pictures.
Right, but I think not everybody, you know, most of the people were, you know, a little barbaric going along, but you fear there had to be some people that were part of the army that, you know, didn't really care for what their, you know, people were, higher up people were doing. But so, yeah, it was kind of interesting how all these things, you know, from one thing to another were preserved. And you figure part of this had to have been true, because then they did end up having, you know, from what they said, you know, pictures of these things that really happened. So people, you know, there's always people that are willing to take the risk to preserve things for the future to let people know this is what really happened. It probably wasn't my favorite book we've read, but, you know, it had some good points, and I see how the things you've discussed are valid, too, so everybody's going to take away certain things, and we all have authors we like and the ones we're not so crazy about.
Yeah, and I think the overall grade in The Cove was a C.
So, yeah, I think you're right. It was sort of average, so, you know, not the best book we've ever read, but not the worst either.
Not the worst, right? It wasn't the worst, yes, and it's always nice to learn about something that's historical.
Right.
Okay, so that's our discussion of the Sandcastle Girls. We want to thank our listeners for tuning in, and as always, please share your thoughts with us down below, and stay tuned for our next episode. We'll be discussing Tilt by Ellen Hopkins. Bye.
Bye.